heuristics and all these, you know, algorithms, explicit algorithms to be able to catch these features in the images. But we're never able, we have never been able to get past the 80%. So let's give it up. And let's have the, you know, a system where we give the system a large amount of label data and train the system and say, this is a cat, this is a dog, whatever, this is a pedestrian. And then have a, you know, a function, essentially a function approximation you know, system that synthesize the logic. We don't understand what the logic is, but in the end, with enough training, the logic was able to beat the explicit algorithms that people came up with. The fundamental problem is that nobody really knows what the real logic should be. Okay, it's not that not only we don't know what the logic is, we actually don't know what the logic should be. So this is a way to cheat our way into a system that we don't know what the logic is supposed to be. But it can be very costly in terms of the computational resources we need to spend and the amount of data we need. So this gives you a characteristic of, you know, of the use of computational, you know, the machine learning based computation versus explicit algorithm based computation. There are different modalities. You know, you can have, you know, obviously image, you know, recognition. You can have audio processing. You can have text processing, and these are the kind of things that people have been spending hundreds of millions of dollars in industry from, you know, companies like Google and Facebook and, you know, Baidu and so on. And you know, because of the value that you can produce on the problems that we have no clue how to come up with the real algorithms. I have a conjecture that eventually these things may actually lead to some real understanding of what the logic should be, but you know, we're not quite there yet. Okay, and this is just, you know, essentially the beginning of these things. And if you look, if you ask me, how far we have gone into this whole you know, this whole revolution, I would say that we're just at the beginning. So you know, this is actually a system that I put together with some of my IBM colleagues, and you know what? So this is kind of a kind of very simplified view of looking at cognitive computing and you know, the silly system that Yale mentioned yesterday, Watson. So if you look at kind of the Watson system, they have a what they call the Watson sub pipelines, and you know, you can simplify things into kind of this level. And the image recognition, text extraction, speech recognition are all front ends to, you know, to a real cognitive computing system. And but in the end, what you really need is to be able to actually do the you know, the real semantic analysis in, for the natural language, for the diagrams you have, and so on. So when you read a cartoon, you know, the human, it's very easy for human to read a cartoon, but it's extremely difficult for an automated system to actually see a cartoon and understand what is being conveyed. So this is actually one of the interesting tests that you know, we have for these kind of systems. So we need to, then once we understood these things, we need to be able to do knowledge indexing and knowledge inferencing. And these are actually areas where we have no clue how to design real algorithms to be able to, you know, to combine the vast amount of knowledge. So for example, in Watson, you know, there's actually a large number of these sub-databases. We're talking about, you know, a large number of databases and tables of, that represent knowledge. But how we can go from one table to another table and combine them in a way that we can synthesize an answer to a question or to be able to understand some of these problems better, it's actually done on a almost random statistical approach in the Watson. And you know what, they actually have what they call the constraint solver that is very crude, using, you know, not enough variables. And as a result, they're getting some ridiculous answers to some of the questions that might be obvious to humans. So we're just at the beginning of this kind of computation. And we can really benefit from being able to solve much bigger inverse problems, that solve much larger integer linear programming equations and so on in these systems. which is not exactly what we're currently using the high-performance computing systems for. Okay? So, you know, in the end, we're seeing more and more heterogeneity coming. So, we have CPUs and GPUs today, but then we also see a lot of these other computing devices coming along. For example, Yale mentioned the FPGA cloud that Derek Chu and Doug Berger are leading in the Microsoft. They're doing some really groundbreaking work in terms of some of the cognitive search problems. And then the ASICs, Google's TensorFlow processing unit, and for designed for machine learning. All these things are just beginning to come together. The most interesting part that I wanted to bring up for this research community is that if you look at what's really happening, very little of that is currently driven by academics. Okay. And that's not good. And I honestly feel that the research community failed to take the lead on some of these very important problems. Turns out that when industry solve these problems, they are solving these problems in a fairly shallow and a fairly with a profit-driven way. And I actually don't think that in the long run, these works will be done properly without very active leadership from the research community. I really think that this is a great opportunity for the research community to really do the right kind of foundational work to be able to solve these problems correctly in the future. So beyond the traditional DRAMs, we have stacked DRAMs for memory bandwidth, we have non-volatile RAM for the memory capacity, we have near in-memory computing for reduced power. All these things are adding to the heterogeneity of our future systems. So this leads us into, is going to be hard in the future. So we see that we have already proven that supercomputing using GPUs can actually be very profitable for some of these applications. And we have seen that GPUs plus big data and deep learning have formed a positive spiral for the industry. If you go to GTC today, the GPU technology conference in March, what happened was that the entire company for NVIDIA is betting on the machine learning industry, right? So that's how much money that these people are betting on these kind of positive spiral cycles. And I honestly think that as a community, we will be able to drive multiples of these spirals. If we tune into the right applications, put together the right technology. So when I was a grad student, I think Yale or Aldous Payne told us once that every decade or so, every couple of decades, there's an opportunity for computer architects. When you have a big application shift, you can have some interesting opportunities as a computer architect. Or if you have an interesting technological shift, then there will be lots of work to do for computer architects. Today we have both. That's why I call this perfect storm. When you have a combination of big application shifts and big technology shifts, this is where the computer architects and the system software people really have career-making kind of opportunities. And so that's why I really feel that this is a great opportunity. But there's one problem that I particularly have been spending time on because we have been seeing a lot of engineering challenges in terms of crafting software for for these applications. So I don't have time to go through this section. So I will just show one slide, which actually was related to what Mark Silverstein was talking about yesterday. So when we program these devices, we see that these devices are actually fairly complex as far as a programmer is concerned in terms of crafting code. So on the CPU side, there are levels of process, threads, vector lanes, and instruction level parallelism. And for the GPUs, we have a minimum of grid, block, warp, thread, and instruction level parallelism. These are abstraction levels that may or may not concern you as audience at this point. But as soon as I start to show code, you will start to see the impact of these hierarchies. So you know, this is a very simplified CPU code where I show the code that corresponds to each level of the hierarchy, you know, when people write reasonably high performance code. So at the process level, essentially what we're doing is we're dividing up the work into, you know, the different processes in the process. In fact, this one is just one process, but we're dividing up the work for the multiple threads in that process. The multiple threads in the CPU code is parallelized by OpenNP. So we're putting in these OpenNP pragmas. Where the, you know, that Yale was kind of talking about. In fact, there was a nice slide about the language pragma yesterday for those of you who, you know, actually pay attention to Yale's slides. And then within the thread, we also need to be able to have enough instruction level parallelism. So this is actually a pragma for the Intel compiler to unroll the loop and do the scheduling. And once you come out, you will summarize the result for the thread, and in the end, the process needs to put together all that work done by the threads into a coherent piece of work. So this is a reduction code with all the pieces that you need to craft for the process for these different levels. And here we see the same application written in the GPU. We also see a very similar pattern. At the grid level, we need to partition the work for the blocks. And for the blocks, we're partitioning work for the threads. So the yellow one is actually the second level partitioning. And then we have an instruction level parallel code. Believe it or not, the GPUs actually need to have instruction level parallelism to get good performance. So you also need to have unrolling in the GPU code. And the computation is not that different from what you will be expecting from the CPU. And this is a very important point that I want you to remember. The code pieces of this thing is not that different from the CPU. The partitioning and the assembly of results are not that different from the CPU. But the particular ways of doing the partitioning and particular ways of indexing in the code is actually quite different, and it can be extremely tedious to do in either of the architectures. So this brings us to a programming interface that we have been developing for the past almost 5 years now. And essentially what we're saying is the kind of code that you're writing for the computing part, the sum, the A and B are actually virtually identical in the CPU and the GPU. It's just the indexing need to be worked out differently. And that's handled by the compiler and handled by the containers. The partitioning kind of things that you need to do for CPU, GPUs are virtually identical. It's just that you need to pick different types, different patterns. And that's also done by the compiler and by the auto-tuner. So this piece of code can be used to generate both the CPU code and GPU code at very high performance. But we have not been able to do a production quality system, but it's still in the research stage. So finally, Yale mentioned something about runtime yesterday, and I really think that it's a very important the insight. No matter how hard we try as programmers or compilers, there are things that we just cannot determine that statically. We have to wait until runtime. One of the most important reasons why this is the case is data dependence. The kind of code that we need to pick in order to run in high performance oftentimes depends on the shape of your data and the size of your data. So until you see the real data, you cannot make that right choice. And more subtle point is that hardware is complex. So a lot of times, no matter how hard we try to predict the performance, even if it does not depend on the data, the hardware is complex enough that sometimes we cannot really distinguish between the kind of, you know, the performance of different pieces of code. So we need to be able to make that runtime choice. So diesel is one of those runtimes that we built to be able to make that choice at runtime. And this was published at the S Plus earlier this year, so I'm not going to bore you with the details. But there's a very interesting result that I wanted to point out here. It turns out this kind of selection is actually important for both CPUs and GPUs. For the CPUs, here we actually took a benchmark from the SHOC benchmark suite from Tennessee and Oak Ridge National Lab. So there are two versions of the code. One is the vector, one is the scalar. The scalar code essentially says every thread will be just processing one row of the sparse matrix. And the vector code uses a warp, or in OpenCL terminology, a wavefront to process a single row in a tree-high reduction manner. Turns out that for the CPUs, if you have random matrix versus a diagonal dominating matrix, the choice of the versions actually can be reversed. And for the GPU, same situation happens. So that's why it's not just a GPU kind of problem. In modern CPUs, you have exactly the same problem. So that's why I'm expecting to see more and more of these runtimes that will do the, I think there's another paper on the inspector, the executor scheduling method yesterday that deals with this kind of problem. We're gonna see more and more papers for this kind of problem in the future. So let me conclude. We are seeing some very large appetite from the applications for more computing power. And they're looking to us, okay, for better computing devices, better computing systems, and so on. And heterogeneity has become the norm of pretty much all the hardware systems. The HPC community is currently seeing about 2 to 3 times application speed up using these heterogeneous devices. And the recent positive spiral between deep learning and GPU computing is definitely causing a lot of investment in industry. And if you look at the number of startup companies, the number of companies that are producing multi-GPU systems, and also the companies that are using multi-GPU systems to do machine learning, is definitely exploding at this point in terms of money. And then the performance portability is actually a nasty problem that we have been kind of sweeping under the rug. And all the application teams are saying, these things are great, but until you allow us to have a reasonable path to take our software, for us to craft a piece of software, and expect that piece of software to run with good efficiency on multiple types of devices, we're not going to invest our effort to really use all these devices. It's going to be too costly for us in the long run. So we have to solve that problem for these companies. And not only that, there are many other problems that I hope that I conveyed through the process, that I really think that this is a great time to be a researcher. It's actually a fantastic time as a grad student. You're looking at major paradigm changes where many of you will be making big contributions, and many of you will be introduced by people like Owner in the future with much bigger achievements and so on. So it's definitely an honor to be here, and I hope that this talk followed Yale's talk in some reasonable way. Thank you.
Any questions to Wen-mei after that inspiring talk?
Professor, my name is Lina.
Yes.
I have a question about the GPU and the machine learning. In the most of machine learning, we use stochastic gradient descent to solve these models. And so actually, the optimization takes most of time.
Yes.
And conventional architecture, even for GPUs, is designed for high throughput, but it's still slow.
Yes.
In my perspective, it's still slow.
Yes.
And I have been thinking about this question since last year, because the quantum computing is actually start emerging and kind of in practice now. Like DBA systems, and Google even have this content television generation lab. And I'm not sure how you envision the future of quantum computing and how it will interact with the supercomputing and artificial intelligence. But frankly, I don't see too many papers in, maybe I have limited knowledge base, but I don't see too many papers published in supercomputing field.
I totally agree. So the, you know, the, going back to Yale's point yesterday, you know, the quantum acceleration is really the biggest potential is that you can theoretically represent a very large number of representation alternatives in one word, and theoretically you can actually use that for machine learning. To you know, to train these different kinds of models. However, I don't think it's quite well understood. So I don't think there's enough research to really be able to map that into the right model. If anyone understands this, Burton Smith that that Yale mentioned yesterday will be the one who will be able to give you a much more intelligent answer. However, I do think that there will be a generation of ASICs that people will be trying to make out of both FPGAs and actually the ASIC chips to be able to do some of these training faster. And you know, my personal view is that we're going to be getting over some of the backpropagation kind of bottleneck with some of ASIC design before we can actually tackle some of the information theory limits in terms of the number of combinatorial patterns with some kind of quantum approach.
Do you think this is a good direction to
Yeah, go? in the long term, but I would definitely pay Burton Smith a visit and then talk to him about it. You know, so far, to be very honest, I did talk to quite a few quantum computing people. The only person I can understand is actually Burton Smith. So you may be a lot smarter than I, but I think Burton Smith is the only person who can actually explain these things in a logical way. So,
thank you.
Yes.
We'll take one more.
So I have a question, kind of goes back in time for you maybe. You addressed the portability issue. It's a huge issue for GPUs. If you had a chance to go back and influence CUDA all over again, what would you do about that? I'd be really curious to hear that.
Okay. You know what? I cannot claim credit for the early development of CUDA. You know, the GPU computing is definitely one of those, I would call the embarrassing moments where the academics didn't really take the leadership and so on. So essentially, I started to participate in 2006, but CUDA is already in motion, right? So there are a few things that, I think they probably have done correctly, and some of the things probably did not do quite correctly. One thing that I think NVIDIA did very correctly is that they put enough, they give you enough of the sort of the performance improvement that you can get by crafting your code carefully, and parallelize your